Yesterday we saw what are the various types of interrupts available in the 8051 microcontroller, and we also discussed what are the various events that actually trigger the specific interrupt in 8051 microcontroller, and we also saw the methods of using an interrupt in an 8051 microcontroller. To quickly review what we discussed in the previous class, we saw how to enable an interrupt, and we also saw how to write an interrupt service routine for a specific interrupt source. We saw how to complete the background task using a main program, and we also discussed how to make sure a particular interrupt event happens for a particular interrupt source. I have also explained to you merely enabling an interrupt and writing an interrupt service routine is not the necessary condition for an interrupt to happen. It is necessary that an event corresponding for that particular interrupt should happen in order to interrupt to take place in a microcontroller. So these are the things that we have already discussed in the previous class. Now in this class, we will see three classes of interrupts. One is an external interrupt. In external interrupt category, we will see INT0 and INT1. We don't include reset in this category because it is non-maskable. The second one is timer interrupt. Timer interrupt will happen when timer 0 and timer 1 overflows respectively. We also see example of how to use a timer interrupt. And the last one is the serial interrupt. You know very well that serial interrupt is triggered because of two events, one transmit and the other one is reception, of which the interrupt triggered because of reception gains more important than transmission, because obviously we don't require interrupt for transmission because that is something which is decided by me. So these are the three broad classifications of interrupts that we will be seeing. First, we will be seeing applications using external interrupts. Then we will see how to see timer, and finally how to use serial interrupt. First, part one is handling an external interrupt. When I say external interrupt, I mean INT0 and INT1. INT0 happens when signal change happens at INT0 pin, that is pin number 12. INT1 happens when there is a change in signal at INT1 pin, which is pin number 13. So these two interrupts, INT0 and INT1, happen by a change of signal at external pin. So which means for this interrupt to happen, you should have an appropriate hardware which force that signal change in either pin number 12 or pin number 13 respectively. So that is what we have discussed in the previous class. And the second important concept that you have to understand with regard to external interrupt is, by default, the interrupt is active for negative level. When the signal undergoes a change from high to low, initially it is at 1, the hardware forces the interrupt line to go to low state. By default, the interrupt is active only for this negative level. This is what is the default. The interrupt happens only for this negative level. This is the default nature of the interrupt in 8051. Which means if the interrupt service routine takes, if the ISR takes delta T amount of time, and if the total time period for which the interrupt line goes to low period T, if T is many times greater than delta T, then in that case, you will have your ISR getting executed multiple times. So this is one bad outcome of level sensitive interrupt. If you wanted to make it edge sensitive, if you wanted to disable this, and if you want your interrupt to get executed only once, then in that case, you have to convert this level sensitive interrupt into edge sensitive interrupt. Convert your level sensitive interrupt to edge sensitive. What do you mean by edge sensitive? The interrupt will be active only during the negative edge. By edge, I mean negative edge. By level, I mean negative level. We are not talking about any positive levels here. So the interrupt will be active only once. When the signal undergoes a change from high to low, the edge can happen only once, which means the interrupt can happen only once. So how do I force my interrupt to be edge sensitive? You have to take the help of timer control SFR, TCON SFR. The TCON SFR, the top four bits are meant for timing. The bottom four bits are meant for interrupt operation. The first bit of the TCON SFR or the LSB is IT0, interrupt type bit. If this bit is zero, that means the interrupt is negative level sensitive. On the other hand, if this bit takes a value of 1, in that case, the interrupt becomes negative edge sensitive. Okay, this is for interrupt 0. And similarly, for interrupt 1, this is IT1, interrupt type bit for interrupt 1. In this case, if this bit takes a 0, again, this is for INT0. INT1 becomes negative level sensitive. On the other hand, if this bit takes a value of 1, then INT1 becomes negative edge sensitive. Okay. The next two bits is called edge flags, IE0 and IE1. They are called interrupt edge flags. These interrupt edge flags for INT0 and INT1 will take a value of 1. They will take a value of 1, IE0 or IE1 will take a value of 1 whenever INT0 or INT1 line undergoes a transition from 1 to 0. When such an edge happens, this fellow takes a value of 1. This is something which we normally don't use, so let us not worry about it. So this is what is more important: how to convert a level sensitive interrupt into an edge sensitive interrupt. So far, clear for all of you? All of you are with me? Are you able to follow what is going on in the class? Okay. Now we'll see some practical examples of using external interrupts. The first example, perform the following task in 8051 microcontroller. The first one is the background task, which is toggling an LED every 1 second. And the second task, which is an interrupt task, is to count the number of times a push button is pressed and display the count value in P1. So I need to have a circuit which counts the number of times a push button is pressed, and the count has to be displayed in parallel port 1. So that is the interrupt task. Okay, so what is the schematic for this? So the background task is toggling port 2.0. So port 2.0 takes a light emitting diode. And that is getting toggled every 1 second. The second one is I need to connect a push button and I need to count it. So though I have the choice of connecting the push button anywhere, purposefully I am connecting the push button to INT0 pin. So INT0 pin is pin number 12. That is where I connect my push button. So this is getting connected to pin number 12. Whenever I am pressing the button, the input that is going to the processor is a boolean 0. Now, the processor should count the number of times I am pressing the button, and it has to display the count value in port 1. So this is my port 1. This is where I get the count value. You can use any display device like a 7-segment display or an LCD display or simply a small set of 8 LEDs to understand the binary output of parallel port 1. So let us start with the source code for this. First one comes enabling the interrupt. So enabling the interrupt, what is the first task that we enable it? We have to make the global interrupt enable all to become 1. That is the first statement. Since I am using INT0 here, I have to enable external interrupt 0. So I make enable external interrupt 0 as 1. Okay, so this is enable all. This is the global interrupt. I am enabling external interrupt 0. So I put enable external interrupt 0 is equal to 1. Both these two bits are available in interrupt enabled SFR, IE SFR, which we discussed yesterday. And more importantly, when I press the button, I want my ISR to get executed only once. So this high to low going edge is what I want to count. I don't want to count this level. So which means, I make IT0 as a 1. Why I need IT0 equal to 1? Because I make IT0 equal to 1 means I make INT0 as edge sensitive. Okay, so this is the thing that I do here. So once you enable the interrupt, and once somebody is pressing the button, interrupt service routine is going to get invoked. And you have to write the interrupt service routine for that. So how do I write the interrupt service routine for that? Void INT0 interrupt service routine, no parameter, interrupt keyword, and the priority number for INT0. Priority number for INT0 is 0. Okay, So what is this ISR should do? It has to increment a counter, and that counter value has to be updated to parallel port 1. So incrementing a counter means what? I have a global variable called counter, which I increment. Counter plus plus. This has to be a global variable, which I increment every time the switch is pressed. Because the control will come here only when the user press the button. Once the user press the button, I automatically increment a counter. Then what I do with that counter value? I display that value to parallel port 1. So this counter value, I am putting it in parallel port 1. These are the two steps that I do, nothing more than that. Are you able to understand? Now here comes my main program. In the main program, obviously the first part is enabling the interrupt, which means these three statements has to be put here. Once I enable the interrupt, I go for infinite while loop. In the infinite while loop, I execute my background task. What is my background task? LED is equal to F1. Delay 1 second. I put LED equal to 0. And I again call delay 1 second. So this completes my background task. Now let us understand how the system works. So the system will come here, the control will come here. It will first execute this part, which means it will initialize the interrupt and then gets into this infinite while loop. Once it enters the infinite while loop, it always executes this infinite while loop over and over again and again, because this is the background task, the task which the microcontroller does under normal cases. Once the user press the button, assuming that he is pressing the button in this particular case, it completes this instruction and then push the return address of the next instruction to stack, and it will make a jump. And it will make a jump to the interrupt service routine, executes this particular set of statements, and then after completing this, it comes out of the interrupt service routine, begins executing this main program again. So whenever interrupt happens, momentarily it stops executing the background task, it jumps to the interrupt service routine, executes it, and comes back to the main program. So every time the interrupt happens, my counter is getting incremented. And every time my count is getting incremented, I am delivering that output to parallel port 1. So this is a simple problem which we can validate it using our simulation here. So this is my switch connected at port 2.0. I am enabling, this is the interrupt enable part. I am putting enable all equal to 1. I am putting enable external interrupt 1. No, we are using external interrupt 0. So I put external interrupt 0, enable external interrupt 0 as a 1, IT 0 as a 1. And then this is my background task. And then this is my delay program. And finally, the interrupt service routine for INT0. The priority number for INT0 is 0. So then I increment a temporary counter. So declare what is counter here. It has to be a global variable. Maybe at the start of the program, you can make counter equal to 0. So every time I increment the count and put the count value to parallel port 1. Port 1 equal to Okay, so go to target, options for target, output, create text file, and compile this. All of you are able to see the Proteus window? Can you see the Proteus window, please? Oh, you are not able to see it. Okay. Is it visible now? Yes. So we have push button connected to power supply. May have a resistor. The resistor is connected to the ground line. The switch is connected to the ground line. So this part we will connect it to port 3. So which is INT0 pin? This is my INT0 pin. So that is where I connect my switch. So port 2.0 has a simple light emitting diode. So this is my port 2.0. And I have a ground connected to it. So I need to understand the count value of parallel port 1. So I connect the output of parallel port 1 with one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So 1.0, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, 1.5. And connect all of them to ground. Connect this to our hex file. And run this application. Uh, It is showing already FF because by default when you power up the microcontroller, all the port pins will have a high value. So which it is better you disable that at the initial of the start of the program. So when you put counter equal to zero, put port one equal to zero. So that will wipe the initial contents of your microcontroller. So the contents are zero and the LED is doing its background task. Now here comes my interrupt task. When I switch this button once, this is incremented only once. So the counter is incremented from 0 to 1 and then again. So this is 0, 2, 3, 4. This is the binary output. So you must be aware of that. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. So the count value is getting incremented every time. You know what will happen if I don't make it edge sensitive, isn't it? If I forgot to put this statement, which means for one single press, the counter will be incremented many number of times because the counter will be active. This interrupt service routine will be active many number of times and the counter will be incremented many number of times for one single key switch. Let us examine that as well. So this is my background task. I just press this once and release it. You see how many number of times it has incremented. It has incremented around 200 plus number of times for a single key press and release. So it is a very dangerous thing to do. If you are expecting that to happen only once, then you make it edge sensitive. If it is level sensitive, then obviously your ISR is going to get triggered multiple number of times. All of you are able to see the kill window, isn't it? Whenever I'm changing this window. Are you able to see the kill window as well as the Proteus window simultaneously when I change that? Okay. So if you stop this and run once again. Now it becomes edge sensitive. It is executing only once I execute the program. Okay, so that is my simple application here. Let us go and revise this same application with a different problem. Example 2. Again, it has two tasks. Background task is again blinking an LED at port 2.0. The interrupt task in this case, you have two push buttons connected to the system. Pressing one button should increment a count. And pressing button 2 should decrement the count. And obviously you have to display the count value at parallel port 1. Okay, so now I want some inputs from you. I'm assuming that you are seeing the presentation window, all of you. Are you? Are you seeing the presentation window? Yes. Now for solving this particular problem, I need to have two push buttons. One push button should increment the count value, the other push button should decrement the count value. Now can you please tell me how many interrupts should I use and what are they? So we need to use two interrupts. That's correct. And what are the two interrupts that we have to use? external interrupt 0 and external interrupt 1. So INT 0 and INT 1. Obviously, these are the two available interrupts, and we need to use external interrupt 0 and 1. Correct. In this case, how many interrupt service routines I have tried? How many interrupt service routines I have tried? Again, 2. When I am using 2 interrupts, everything becomes 2 now. Okay, so let us try and write them again. So this is my background task. And I have 2 push buttons. One push button is connected to pin number 12. I call this as button 1. There is another button connected to 13. I call this as button 2. So in this case, we are using both INT 0 and INT 1, which means I have to enable 2 interrupts here. Listen here. Enable all equal to 1. This is my global interrupt. Enable external interrupt 0 and make it edge sensitive. I2 0 is equal to 1. This is for external interrupt 0. And then enable external interrupt 1 and make that also as edge sensitive. Sorry, IT1. IT1 is equal to 1. Okay. So I am making global interrupt on, external interrupt 0 on, make it edge sensitive. External interrupt 1 on, make it edge sensitive. Right. In this case, we need to write 2 statements, 2 interrupt service routines. First interrupt service routine, void INT0 ISR interrupt. What is the priority number for interrupt 0? 0. So what should happen when button 1 is pressed? I have to increment a counter and update the count value to port 1. And I have to write another interrupt service routine for INT1. Void INT1 ISR interrupt. What is the priority number for INT1? Not 1. Priority number of 1 is for timer 0 overflow. So the priority number for INT1 is 2. In this case, I am decrementing the counter. Counter minus minus. And I am updating the same count value to counter. Are you able to understand? And the main program obviously is the same. First part is enabling the interrupt. This entire block comes here. And I make counter value equal to 0. And I make port 1 also to be 0. And then I go for while 1 loop. In the while 1 loop, I execute the background task. So background task is blinking this LED. Are you able to understand? Now let us change the source code for that. So, in addition to external interrupt 0, I also make external interrupt 1 as 1. I make it edge sensitive. So that is one thing. Then I also write a interrupt service routine for external interrupt 1. Void int1 ISR interrupt priority number is 2. So what should happen when button 2 is pressed? Counter minus minus. Put port 1 is equal to counter. Okay, background task is still the same. We are not changing that. Now let us go back to our hardware. So this block we will copy. External interrupt 1 has to be connected with this fellow. So this is my button 1 and this is my button 2. If you want some reference, you can put a text there. Button 1, B1. Just button 2. Just for our understanding. Okay, so let us run this code. So this is my background task running. Now let us press the button 1, which will increment the count value. 1, 2, 3. So let us press button 2 and see what happens. 3 becomes 2, 2 becomes 1, 1 becomes 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. 7 becomes 6, 6 becomes 5, 5 becomes 4. 4 becomes 3, 3 becomes 2, 2 becomes 1, 1 becomes 0. And if you subtract 1, again it becomes 255. It goes in the reverse direction. And if you increment 255, it becomes 0. So it is perfectly working the way that I wanted. Is that clear for you all? Are you able to follow what is going on in the class? Yes. Now this external interrupt is a very powerful way in which you can, you know, do a lot of useful applications. One possible way of using that is you have designed a digital frequency meter, isn't it? Digital frequency meter. How did you design the digital frequency meter? You connected a clock source, and a clock source is connected to the timer pin in the previous case. We have connected the timer pin with the digital clock, and then we use the counter to count it. You can also connect the clock to either INT0 and INT1 and make use of a temporary variable called a counter in this case, and count that and then determine the frequency. So you can also use interrupt for counting the number of clock pulses that are coming to a particular input, in this case INT0 or INT1. And then determine what is the frequency of the clock, just you did in the case of timer. That is also possible. So you can design a lot of interesting applications here. The other way of using interrupt is to use an analog to digital converter. In our ADC example, we used start of conversion and waited for end of conversion to happen. End of conversion, how it will happen? End of conversion will happen from a high to low. EOC will be triggered from high to low. So if I connect the end of conversion line of ADC to external interrupt 0 or external interrupt 1, I can make the ADC to trigger the interrupt of my microcontroller, and I write an interrupt service routine to collect the ADC data. That is also possible. So you can just make use of the interrupt line and connect an external hardware in such a way that the external interrupt pin, either INT0 or INT1 pin, is pulled low, and you write an interrupt service routine to manage that in your source code. Okay, so that is pretty straightforward. Okay, now let us move on to the second part of our interrupt discussion, that is managing timer interrupts. Timer interrupts are processed or managed for timer 0 and timer 1. When timer 0 and timer 1, both of them, when they overflow, their respective timer overflow flag, TF0 or TF1, both of them will become 1. In that case only, the timer interrupt is fired. So how to use timer interrupts? Timer interrupts are used for triggering periodic interrupts. Periodic interrupts means what? I want an interrupt to happen at periodic intervals of time. I want an interrupt every 1 millisecond, every 200 microsecond, every 500 microsecond. This is called periodic interrupts. Periodic interrupts are widely used for waveform generation. Are you able to understand? In this case, design a simple application using timer interrupt. So again, this is having two tasks. The background task, I am retaining the same. I am not doing anything. In task two, the application should generate a square waveform at 1 kilohertz at port 1.0. This is an interrupt task. Are you able to understand? So there is no difference in the background task. Task two, I should generate a square waveform at port 1.0 at 1 kilohertz. So when frequency is equal to 1 kilohertz, the time period is equal to 1 by f. 1 by 1 kilohertz becomes 1 millisecond. So 1 millisecond means here is a square waveform. The complete time period becomes 1 millisecond. So t is equal to 1 millisecond. So when t is equal to 1 millisecond, what is on period or t on? T on equal to 0.5 milliseconds. Similarly, t off becomes another 0.5 milliseconds. On period is 0.5 milliseconds and off period is 0.5 milliseconds. Now, how do we design this system using interrupt-based approach? There is one background task already running. So, as a designer, I should trigger a timer interrupt every 0.5 milliseconds. Why every 0.5 milliseconds? Because the signal is changing every 0.5 milliseconds. A 1 becomes 0, a 0 becomes 1 every 0.5 milliseconds. So we need to trigger a timer interrupt every 0.5 millisecond or 500 microseconds. Are you able to understand? So I need to trigger a timer interrupt every 0.5 milliseconds or 500 microseconds. So that is what is my objective. So when I'm using timer interrupt, which timer you are going to use for your application, you have to design. Because we are already using timer zero for generating delay for background task. Timer zero is already taken away from you. So we use timer one for our interrupt application. Okay, so that is what we have to do. Now let us go and design this particular thing. The first one is of course the background task, which is happening at port 2.0. And the interrupt task is generating a square waveform at port 1.0. At a frequency of 1 kilohertz. Okay, so this is an interrupt task. This is the background task. Now, let us enable the interrupt. Enable all equal to 1. Okay, so that is global interrupt. Which interrupt we are using? Timer 2 overflow interrupt. Which means enable. Not timer 2, timer 1, sorry. Timer 1 overflow interrupt. So enable all equal to 1. Enable timer 1 is equal to 1. This is timer 1 overflow interrupt. Are you able to understand? Now we'll go to the main program straight away. What I do in the main program? Void main. First thing is enabling the interrupt. Before I go to the infinite while loop and execute the background task, I have to make sure that the timer interrupt happens. Are you able to understand? Always remember this fourth condition. What is the fourth condition? Enabling an interrupt is fine. Writing an interrupt service routine is fine. Writing a background task is fine. Make sure the interrupt event happens. What is the meaning of this? For external interrupts, interrupt is triggered by a signal change in the external pin. That is anyway done by an external hardware. How that interrupt event is done for timer interrupts? By making timer 0 or timer 1 to overflow. When they will overflow, provided we start the timer with some initial value and make the timer to run, which we have to take care. Otherwise, the timer overflow interrupt will never run. So the first thing that we have to do is to set the mode of the timer. T mode is equal to hexadecimal. I want the mode of timer 1 in 16-bit mode. Already we are using timer 0 also in 16-bit mode. 16-bit mode means mode 1. So what is the mode setting for 16-bit mode for both timer 0 and timer 1? It is 11 hexadecimal. 11 means timer 0 in 16-bit, timer 1 in 16-bit. Both the timers are 16-bit modes. Why I needed 16-bit mode for timer 0? Because it is used for delay. Why I need 16-bit mode for timer 1? Because I am using it for interrupt. Both of them are in 16-bit mode. Now, you load TL1 and TH1 with